Thank you, children, chancel choir, handbells, for getting this day started off so beautifully. What a wonderful day this is in the life of our church as we gather to celebrate Heritage Sunday and 50 years in this beautiful sanctuary. Thank you for being here and being a part of this very special day. It is great to see each and every one of you. Do want to extend a special welcome. I know we have a number of visitors with us, and we want to say welcome to you. Thank you for sharing with us today in worship. We'd like to ask if you would take just a second to look in the pew rack in front of you. There's a visitor's card. In fact, we call it now a Connect card. If you take that card and complete it front and back, and then take it to the welcome desk following the service located at the front entrance of the sanctuary, we'd like to be able to greet you further, answer any questions you may have about the church, and also give you any information you would like to have. But most of all, it's great to have you with us. We welcome you today, and it's good to see you here worshiping today with us. Also want to remind all of you to fill out the attendance pads located on the pews. And please, if you have any changes to any of your information, we would greatly appreciate your making those changes so we can update our database and be able to contact you as needed in the days ahead. Thank you for doing that for us. What a great day this is. This has truly been in the planning for a year, this particular service. Through our History Committee, Worship Committee, Outreach Assimilation Committee, all these different groups coming together to put together this wonderful day. One of the wonderful things that comes out of that preparation is this beautiful booklet that you've been provided with. So I hope you will take that and keep it and look back on it from time to time as we remember this day of celebration. But most of all today, if you're looking for a bulletin, the order of worship is right there. So there it is. Some folks have asked, well, where's the bulletin today? Where's the bulletin? Well, the order of worship is right there, and you'll have that in front of you to use throughout this service this morning. Do want to thank everyone, again, who's been a part of this. We have preparations being made in Bailey Hall right now for a covered dish luncheon immediately following this service of worship, and we hope you'll make plans to attend that. Even if you're visiting with us, I can guarantee you that this church has enough food to feed you. So please make your way back to Bailey Hall immediately following the service and we'll enjoy a great lunch together. Also, immediately following the service, we would like all of our 50-plus year members to gather here at the front, along with those children of the 60s who weren't yet members, here at the front of the sanctuary for a picture. And also any of our pastors that are here from recent years, we'd like you to do the same. Join us here at the front so they can have pictures made immediately following the service. Also, when you go to Bailey Hall to have lunch, we have a book that's going to be available for sale, $5. Eloise Thompson, our church historian, wrote this book a number of years ago now, but it's a great history of the church here and all that we've done over the last 200-plus years here in this community. If you don't have it, it's a wonderful addition to your library. $5 today in Bailey Hall. You'll see the display set up there, and we hope you'll purchase a book for you and your family. Also want to, there's going to be a lot of special recognitions today, as you might expect on a day like this, but I want to recognize a person right at the beginning here, Betty Kettlebader. Betty, where are you? Please stand. Betty, there she is right here. Betty, she was the first organist and accompanist that we had here in this sanctuary, and she's made her way to be with us today. Betty, thank you so much for being a part of this service today. Several announcements to draw your attention to. First of all, our long-range planning committee meets this weekend, but you are included. As we begin our continued preparations on our five-year plan, one of the things we are asking you as a congregation to do is to meet with us. We need your input. This next Saturday morning, starting at 9 o'clock in Bailey Hall, you're invited to come and to find out where we are in the process, but also offer your ideas, your hopes, your dreams for this church in the next 5 years. So you'll see the information for you in the information sheet that was passed out to you coming in next Saturday morning, 9 to 1 in Bailey Hall. Please make that a priority, a very important time in the life of our church. Hope you'll be here to participate in that particular meeting. Also, I want to remind you that the Samaritan's Purse Project is going on. This is a project that our Good Timers Older Adults Group has done for a number of years now. You'll see the empty shoe boxes located in the front entrance of the sanctuary as well as in classrooms. Carol, share a little bit more about what goes in those boxes.
Samaritan's Purse shoe boxes are, they have a box and inside it the directions
And it's age-related, so you can girls or boys too as well. And if you fill it up with it, you make it so it can still be closed. There's a rubber band in there to put around it. And these will be going from here to the Baptist Church, because that's the distribution center for this area. Then they will in turn be picked up by Samaritan's Purse people, and they'll carry them up to the National Distribution Center, and they'll make sure all of them meet the requirements, and then they'll have it sent off. So in time for these kids to get their Christmas boxes. We'd like for you, they're distributed around here, and then Sunday school buildings, so please pick up one and fill it. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Appreciate that. And thank you for what you're going to do to make that project a success. A few other brief announcements. This afternoon is our charge conference. We meet with the Area United Methodist Churches in a group charge conference at 2:30 this afternoon in Kingsland. Hope the church council members especially will plan to be there, but all are invited to share in that time of worship and celebration with our churches in this particular area. Dara, I saw that hand. Do you have an announcement?
Sing, do our thing, have a short rehearsal afterwards, and shoot me a text if you need a ride from Kingsland to here for you, okay? Parents, please bring them there, and then let me know if you need a ride from there to here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dara. Also, the devotional books that we've had on sale for children, that sale, a deadline has been extended to next Sunday. So if you have children and would like to get one of the devotional books, please make that order. Also, Boston Butt Sales to benefit our youth missions in the next year are going on. The deadline for Boston Butts purchases is next week as well. And then Trunk or Treat's coming up, and I know Tina would like to hear from you regarding whether or not you're going to have a car or truck decorated for Trunk or Treat, as well as any candy you'd like to donate if you can't be here to help us with that particular program coming up in just a couple weeks as well. Lots going on in the life of our church. We have a great church. Many opportunities to invite and grow and serve together. I hope you'll be aware of those opportunities through not only the bulletin, but through the e-blast on Thursdays, as well as our church website, and take advantage of all those opportunities to invite people to join us, to grow together in our faith, and to serve Christ as he calls us to do. Let's stand now and greet each other with a word of welcome.
Good morning. Please bow your heads as we open with prayer. Almighty God, receive our praise and thanksgiving for the blessings, help, and comfort which you have provided for your people in this place from its foundation. Continue, we pray, your many mercies in our church, that we may be conscious at all times of your unchanging love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
each of the hymns listed and the pages that they're on. Please stand as you're able. Join me on page 881 and reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father. be seated.
Good morning. My name's Cindy Fitzgerald, and I'm the lay leader. And today, I want to recognize some very important people. But before I begin, let me just give a little bit of history. So it was Sunday, September 11th, 1966. The U.S. president was Lyndon B. Johnson. People were listening to You Can't Hurry Love by the Supremes. And on this Sunday in September, pitcher Nolan Ryan played his first Major League Baseball game. But in our little corner of Georgia, the St. Mary's United Methodist Church worshiped in their new sanctuary for the first time. On this day, one of the saints of our church, Bob Dean and his wife Mildred, baptized their son Michael. What a perfect time to welcome a new member into God's kingdom. And Michael's here today with us, along with Mrs. Dean. And today, we'd like to recognize St. Mary's United Methodist Church members with 50 years or more. Without their vision, hard work, and prayers, we wouldn't be sitting in this beautiful sanctuary. If you're able, would you please stand if you're a 50-year-plus member? Let's all give them a round of applause. Thank you. But we're also going to recognize the children who of the church in 1966 and have spent most of their years worshiping in this very sanctuary. I want to thank you for your faithfulness and devotion to our church. Would you also please stand? I know you're out there. Thank you. And you may not know this, but today is also Laity Sunday, and we want to remember the ministry of the laity, knowing full well, without the servant leadership of our laity from the very beginning, we wouldn't be the church that we are today. Our laity is heavily involved in many aspects of leading, teaching, serving, and outreach to the community and to the world. Thank you for all that you do to strengthen St. Mary's United Methodist Church. Without your service, we would not have the longstanding tradition of being a giving, serving, and active church. And let's all go give ourselves a round of applause for what we do for this church. Thank you and enjoy the service.
We also want to take this opportunity to recognize the pastors that have served in this church over the past 50 years. They're listed on the inside cover of your bulletin. And you'll see there that their names are listed, except for, and regrettably, three associate pastors that we just inadvertently left out. I apologize to our associates that have served this church, and in no way reflects upon their vital ministry that they had with us here, and we apologize for that oversight. But they included our associates, in addition to that list, Diane Holt, Jim Morrow, and Brenda Ginder. And lo and behold, the only one of those pastors that came back is one of those we left off the list. Brenda Ginder is here with us today. Brenda, please stand and let us show our appreciation to you. All the pastors were invited to attend, and a number of them are currently serving appointments, so they couldn't break away today from their particular churches to be with us, but all send their regards and their love and appreciation for the people of St. Mary's. I did receive several notes there, though, from some of the former pastors, and I wanted to share some of their thoughts with you this morning. First of all, Richard Altman. Richard had sent a note early on saying that his wife, Pat, was ill, very ill, and that they may not be able to make it. He sent me a note again this week saying that because of Pat's illness and the fact that she was now in her hospice care, they would not be able to attend. And then yesterday we heard the news that Pat had passed away. And so we keep Richard Altman and his family in our prayers today in a special way as they have a service for Pat this afternoon in Byron, Georgia, at the Byron United Methodist Church. Billy Key, also pastor of this church. Excuse me. Billy is in an assisted living center in Dublin. His wife, Sunshine, writes that they appreciated the invitation and that they're so sorry they will not be able to attend. They thoroughly enjoyed their time in St. Mary's, and the congregation was simply a joy to minister to and with. Jim Snell sent his regards. Jim and his wife, Joanne, sent their regrets, saying they could not be with us, but expressed appreciation for the invitation. Also had the opportunity to speak with John and Lynn Mitchell. John, as you may know, is not doing well physically either. He's battling Parkinson's and is unable to really travel very much anymore, but Lynn and he both expressed their love and appreciation for you, the people of St. Mary's United Methodist Church. Now, we are very pleased to have, I should say, there are two people off of that list that came today. One is our special guest preacher, Wayne Mosley. Wayne, please stand. Wayne, former pastor of this church and now my boss as the district superintendent of the Coastal District. But Wayne, it is so good to have you with us. And Sharon, his lovely bride, is with him as well. Sharon, please stand and let us show our appreciation to you as well. I know they had a tremendous ministry here, and Wayne will probably be sharing some of those thoughts later on when he speaks to us, but it's so good to have them with us, and you'll see a complete biography on Wayne's ministry on the inside cover of the bulletin. Now we move to a very special part of the service with a video presentation of a celebration of 50 years in our sanctuary. Enjoy.
And sings my soul, my Savior God to thee.
Sometimes you have to dream big dreams. That's what the leadership of St. Mary's Methodist Church did in 1964. The church's wonderful sanctuary had been its home for almost 110 years, and it hosted so many memories. But now on Sundays, folks filled every available space. Some Sundays, they even sat on the lawn outside its doors. So in 1964, the leadership of the church asked, "What if we built a new home? If we do," they dreamed, "we will have room for even more people seeking Christ." They even dreamed of one day where we would have 800 or more members. And yes, maybe there was another reason inspiring this vision.
So we did get a preacher in Lloyd Scott, and he kind of pushed this thing. In fact, he was one of these guys that sweat a lot. And that old sanctuary that didn't have air conditioning. and he was ready to get in some air conditioning.
But dreams can be expensive. A new sanctuary would cost an estimated $125,000. For a small church, this was a large number to digest.
Today, well, there were a lot of people that said this building was good enough for my grandparents, and it's good enough for me. And we don't need a new sanctuary. And it almost divided the church.
Our budget had been so small.
Oh, yeah.
And all of a sudden, here we are thrown with this big, big bill. Mm-hmm. And how are we going to pay for it?
Right.
You know, this was not prosperous times.
Members ultimately chose to be dreamers, too. Plans were approved for the 360-seat building. The project wound up costing $160,000. The new sanctuary hosted its first service in the fall of 1966. With its breathtaking stained glass cross and soaring ceilings, it stood as a symbol of God's blessing and majesty. To young members, it was simply amazing.
Yeah, I just remember it being kind of almost breathtaking to walk in. It was just, you know, you've never seen anything quite like it before. But I also remember as a child sitting, supposed to be listening, and counting the boards across the top of the ceiling.
Right.
At one time, I knew how many boards there were.
The lights, the light fixtures, the stained glass was so pretty to me. I remember fascinated by that. And, of course, the cross was so prominent.
We learned that building the sanctuary was the right thing to do.
Today, we are honoring those who have been members of St. Mary's United Methodist Church for 50 years or more. Here are some of their memories from the early days of the new sanctuary, and some memories as well from members who were children back then.
And another thing I'd like to say is how much I miss the old oak tree. My children have been taken behind that tree several times out of church.
They at least got a tongue lashing.
Right.
I think it was with Derek was pastor, it may have been Brother Snell. Something happened at the mill, and every manager that was in the mill that had a beeper got beat. So he was right in the middle of his sermon, all the men left. I just remember going, was it something I said? there wasn't anybody else hardly in the church because there was a problem at the mill.
So. I know Bob, and I love the greeters. He did always stand at the back and greet every Sunday.
He was our...
He loved it. Mm-hmm. He got the most enjoyment out of it I've ever seen him.
Yeah.
Well, he would say something to people out in the open, you know, when he goes somewhere. Every time he goes somewhere, he'd ask them, do you go to church?
Right. What church says, do you have a home church?
Yes, he says, and if you don't have one, we'd love to have you.
That's right. And the Methodist women, we were told that we had to furnish the choir room in the new building. We helped with the kitchen, furnishing that. It got to where a lot of us would have, we would invite our friends over to the house for either a meal or cake and coffee, and we would put a basket in the middle of the table, and everybody would chip in whatever they could afford to put in the basket. It got to the point where if you invited somebody to your house, they would say, how much is it going to cost me?
In the year 2000, longtime member Warren Bailey passed away. A reclusive man who owned the local phone company, Mr. Bailey had left the bulk of his estate to the church. But not even Derek McAleer, the pastor at the time, knew of Mr. Bailey's plans.
Warren had made me the executor under his will, and so I knew what the will said, but I certainly couldn't say anything. And I had tried to get Warren not to give that money to the church because I thought it could ruin the church having all that money. That morning, Derek came over to the house, and I said, Derek, I need to go out front. I got something I've got to tell you. I said he left almost everything to the church. And he just slumped. And he said, oh, my goodness, what in the world? He said, what kind of money are we talking about? I said, I don't know. Certain it's at least $20 million. And I thought he was going to fall out faint on the ground because I think he had the same kind of fears. Immediately, what are we put in the world? How much controversy is that going to cause?
Ultimately, it was determined that the Bailey bequest was worth $62 million, not $20 million. But what was to be done with this unexpected blessing? A series of membership-wide meetings resulted in an inspired vision. $10 million would be distributed to more than 100 Camden County churches and to help build Magnolia Manor, the Methodist Boys Home, and Wesley Glen. $42 million of the bequest would endow a foundation. To date, that foundation has awarded grants totaling $24 million to tax-exempt organizations in Southeast Georgia, the nation, and the world.
So all that money that's been earned over the years and paid out has provided just unbelievable ministries, or our ministries worldwide at St. Mary's United Methodist Church.
Our grand sanctuary of rich woods and richer memories has witnessed so many of God's blessings through the last 50 years. It has been a period of difficult setbacks with the closing of the paper mill, but also of great developments with the opening of the Kings Bay Navy Base in 1979. And within these walls, we've celebrated both the 175th and 200th anniversaries of our church. We've continued to grow, including the addition of Bailey Hall, which was funded by Mr. Bailey before he died. But more important, we have continued to grow in our spiritual service and outreach as we strive to do the Lord's work and make disciples of Jesus Christ. Our success stories are many. Happy Apple Academy was started in 1981. Now, with 131 students and 11 staff members, it has become a preeminent preschool within Camden County. Helping Hands, our food pantry, began in back of the old church office. Now, it has its own building on Church Street. In 2015, it served almost 6,500 individuals and handed out nearly 91,000 pounds of food. Each week, our Share-A-Meal program prepares 160 meals and serves 40 families. Our Thanksgiving Day dinner annually feeds hundreds of needy from the community. The list of our missions and ministries expands every year. One of our mission groups recently worked with the needy in Honduras. Our youth choir and youth ministries both undertake annual mission trips throughout our local region. Inside the walls of this sanctuary, we worship, we sing, we pray, we mourn the passing of members. We celebrate their marriages, baptize their young, and embrace our newcomers. In the last 50 years, our membership has grown to more than 800, the number envisioned so many years ago by our big dreamers if the new sanctuary was built. What a blessed and wonderful 50 years it has been.
With the changes in the community, you know, we went from just this little small community to the Navy came in right as I got out of high school, and our community completely changed. So then by the time we came back to St. Mary's, there was the old faces, but a lot of new faces too, which has been wonderful that we now have, we blend the old with the new, and hopefully we can just continue to evolve and, you know, be an ever-changing church with our ever-changing world with our non-changing God.
Then sings my song, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my song.
What a great video. Many hours went into this video. Thank you very much to all that put this together. Now, as we move into our time of prayer, would you please bow your head with me? Heavenly Father, we'd like to thank you for this day and your many blessings. Lord, we thank you for the special place you have given us to worship. We thank you for this church family to worship with. And we thank you for filling this house with your awesome presence. We give you thanks and praise for all your blessings, seen and unseen. But Lord, we know we can never thank you enough for the gift of your Son Jesus and his sacrifice for us. The gift that washes away our sins and gives us life, hope, and salvation. Lord, we know that we fall short of your glory. We ask for your forgiveness and guidance to do what you'd have us do in our day-to-day lives. Father, we lift up our prayer concerns to you this morning. We ask that you would give your comforting touch to Adele Hamilton and her family as she grieves the loss of her sister. Lord, we pray for Richard Pippin and Bea Krause and all the others in need of your healing hand. We pray for our men and our women in the military, home and abroad, and for our first responders that protect and serve us every day. We pray for those still affected from Hurricane Matthew and ask for a quick recovery. And we especially pray for those who don't know your love. Help them find you today. As we move towards your message for us today, we ask a blessing on Miss Tina and the children's lesson as they learn more about you and Children's Church this morning. We ask that you open our ears and soften our hearts as we receive your word. Let Reverend Mosley's words be your words, and let us hear your voice in us today. And now, we join together in the prayer your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And now I'd like to invite Miss Tina and all the children to come forward for Children's Church.
Different. Well, that's the way things work sometimes in our normal everyday life. And God has these wonderful things that He gave us. Jesus, He did these parables, these stories that talk about everyday things, like seeds. Like, did you know there's stories in the Bible about seeds? Did you know that? How in the world is that going to help us today? A seed. Do any of you farm?
Oh, I have a seed.
You have a seed? Okay. But do you see that He gives us this wonderful Bible, so we have all these wonderful resources that you may read about and you go, a seed? How is that going to help? And then you read it and you realize, oh, that's what He meant. And then when you, maybe 20 years down the road, can you imagine 20 years from now? How many of you can imagine that?
I'd be 29.
Yeah, it feels like forever, right?
I don't feel like
it's going to go just like that. And you reread that story, and God has you read it again because it hits home for something else in your life, something else that's happening. So we never just want to read the Bible once. We want to read it over and over again because it's just like a movie. Sometimes you're going to watch it and you're going to see something else in it. You read the Bible and you'll see different lessons. All right. Let us pray real quick. Dear God, thank you so much for this wonderful church and all the blessings that it has brought from generation to generation. Please grow these children to be sitting in these pews 50 years from now with their great-grandkids, talking about how wonderful it was to grow up in your word. In your precious name, amen.
I don't believe we'll be here to see it. Okay, I see what it is.
Lord, our Savior.
Please stand for our offertory hymn, As You're Able. Hymn number 64, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for all of your blessings to us, blessings in this place, and blessings that are evident each and every day in our lives. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to show our love and appreciation and our faithfulness to you through this opportunity to give of our gifts. Bless the gifts. Use them for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name.
Stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul. Thank you. sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin.
Good morning, St. Mary's. How good it is to be here in this place to celebrate this amazing day in the life of the church. I am both overjoyed and humbled at the same time for the opportunity to be here and to share with you your Heritage Sunday, 50 years of ministry in this building. And Tom, I've just developed a even deeper appreciation for your ministry. 40 years of ministry, I have never moved the choir, and yet you've been able to do that. I don't understand that. We've always had an agreement with choirs. I'll leave you alone. You leave me alone. We'll get along. But that's amazing to me. And the audio visual is wonderful. Thank you. This church has progressed in so many ways that I just commend you. Thank you for the ways you are moving forward to reach more persons for Jesus Christ. That is our mission. That is our goal. That is what we are about. And I celebrate with you 50 years in this sanctuary. It is the only sanctuary that I know of in South Georgia Conference that actually responds or speaks back to you while you preach. You can hear, I'm not sure if it's agony of persecution of the saints that the pastor is providing, or if it is affirmations that it is a wonderful affirmation. But anyway, it does creak a bit. And it's been doing that for a long time. But it's a wonderful and a beautiful sanctuary, and you have made it even more beautiful. Thank all of you for who have had part in the service today and for all the work that has gone on to celebrate. We don't do enough celebrating in the life of the church. I'm convinced of that. We have a lot to celebrate, don't we? And you have a whole lot to celebrate. Over 200 years of history, 50 years in this building, and a lot in the old chapel. Sharon and I reflect from time to time over memories that we have in our 40-plus years of ministry in serving Christ. And many of those memories lead us right back here to St. Mary's. You have, you're a part of us. And as you grow and develop, as I see more and more new faces, I celebrate with you that this church is living up to God's call upon it and reaching the goal that was set 50 years ago of having just a vibrant, full congregation that would fill up a building that just allows more people to come to worship and celebrate faith. Well, you came today to hear God's word, and I want us to do that. That's the important part of our time together, but I did want to say thank you. I am so blessed, and Sharon and I are grateful for the privilege we have of being here today. In the Gospel of Matthew, the 13th chapter, I'll be reading selected verses, beginning with the 31st verse, but I'm going to ask you to stand in honor of God's holy word for the hearing of the gospel. Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of all shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. This is the reading of God's most holy and sacred word. It is the word of God for the people of God. And the people respond, thanks be to God. You may be seated. Would you pray with me? O Lord our God, come now. And in the power of your Holy Spirit, speak to us that even as the boards of the roof respond to the word, that they will respond in applause. for the great God that we serve and your call upon our lives. Blessed be the name of the Lord. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Have you ever received more than you expected? Now, the truth of the matter is that every one of us, if we reflect upon that, when you think about your life, you think about the things that have happened in your life, you cannot keep from saying, yes, I've received many times far more than I expected, far more than I deserved. Such is the God whom we serve, who gives us all the time more than we expect. And we're going to talk about that a bit this morning as we look at five parables. Don't get too antsy. I know Tom did say I could preach to 12, but I'll try not to try to get us out of here plenty of time. Wow, more than we expected. It is out of that sense of the awesomeness of provision of God upon our lives that we think of how many ways in which God has worked in our lives. Many times that we know He's been working behind the scenes, guiding us, directing us, caring for us, bringing His healing touch, His mercy, and His grace. Now, sometimes we are guilty, I am guilty, of getting in the mully grubs. And if you're not sure about that word, it's somewhat South Georgia term, meaning, well, you're kind of down in the dumps, maybe depressed, maybe despondent. You're just having a bad time, a bad season in life. I suspect that every one of us here, we've had a few of those somewhere along the journey. And when you get in the mully grubs, sometimes it has a way of just clouding over the wonder, the awe, the beauty of the God whom we serve. It taints your vision and keeps you from seeing the good things that God is doing because you're just not at a good place. I want to share with you four things. If you don't take anything else from me from the sermon today, take these with you. These are four things that will keep you out of the mully grubs and will help you to stay lifted up and encouraged. Number one, every person here has someone who loves you no matter what. You know what a gift that is? Somebody here loves you. When you're bad, when you're good, it loves you no matter what. It's an amazing thing to me, but it's a grace, and I thank God for it. Every single person here, you're precious in God's sight. You know that? Sometimes we don't think of ourselves very precious. We think of the things that we've done and we feel guilt. We feel shame. But we are precious in God's sight. He created us. He loves us. Another takeaway. No matter what we do, there is nothing that will keep God from loving you. You believe that? no matter what, no matter how bad, no matter how good, nothing is going to keep God from loving you. And a fourth one, there is, you cannot put a price on the gift of one day that God gives you in this world. You can't buy it. You can't add to it. You can subtract from it, I guess. But God gifts us with these days. And He does it graciously. And it helps us to see that God's care of us is so amazing, so wonderful. Well, to me, these are four ways, at least, that we can stay out of the mully grubs and keep our focus upon the beauty of life and the God who has given it. God's Word today draws us to a life of such quality and such value that we could never and should never take away from that. It is a gift from God given to you, given to me, which we are to live out and to serve Him. Jesus tells us in these five parables all about the kingdom of heaven, and which is to think about the amazing way that God works in this realm. Let me just read the two of these parables again. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which someone stumbled upon, then hid, then in his joy, get that, in his joy, he's found something wonderful. He went and sold all that he had. How much did he sell? All. And he bought the field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. Of finding one pearl of great value, he sold all that he had and bought the pearl of great price. How much did he give for that pearl? All. All. That's right. And that's a clue, if you will, if you want to delve into these amazing parables. You see, when we discover the treasure of God's kingdom, it has the power to transform us to such a degree that we're just willing to give all that we got. All that we got. We're willing to say, here I am, Lord. I'm yours. These days you've given me are yours. This life you've given me is yours. I'm sold out. Take me and use me for your purposes. Let me just witness to this a bit. There was a season in my life where I was going through the motions, if you will. Went to church every Sunday. Life was good. I had a great job, and then something happened. The something that happened was that God intervened in my life. And He showed me in so clear fashion that I was living my life about that deep, about an inch deep and a mile wide. That I was doing the right things. I was living a fairly good life. And yet, God revealed that He had something better for me to do. I spent over 40 years now trying to live into that vision. And wow, it's been one wonderful journey. And of course, 6 years of that journey were spent right here. God wills for us to enjoy the greater calls upon our lives that transforms us. And it's still transforming after well over 40 years. And Sharon would very quickly tell you, God needs to do a little bit more work. And she's right. She's right on target. God is not through with me yet. And I suspicion he's not through with you either. But the thing is, he is calling us to live into this great vision that he has for us, and he's daring to use us. That astounds me. I often think, God, you could do better. I think you could have picked a better candidate here. But the fact that you're chosen is an amazing and wondrous thing. We live in a world that is really struggling. It's looking for meaning in life. You don't have to go far to find or to realize that. People are trapped in lives of dullness, of routines that have little value, little meaning to them. They feel trapped in those arenas. They're busy as all get out, but their busyness does not fulfill the vacuum in their heart, something that is missing. We are here today because we know what that empty place is. It's the love of God, and he's the only one that can fill that vacuum in our lives. He's the only one that can give the kind of meaning and give the quality of life that we will for our lives. We want it to be a life of quality. We want it to be a life that matters, makes a difference. We have discovered something of such value that we have said, Lord, I will give up whatever in order to have the kind of relationship with you, the kind of quality of life that will be abundantly full and running over with the great joy and the wonders of the fruits of your Spirit. We can speak personally about how God has interacted our lives. And do not take that for granted. That's your witness. That's what God has given you, where you can encounter persons, whether they... Bob Deem was such a good example. You can go to the grocery store and be a strong witness for Christ right there. You can go to any place in this area or another area and be a witness for Christ, where people can see in us the qualities of values that are missing if we do not have Christ in our lives. It is that which brings people to Christ. How many people have come to Christ because they've encountered one of us and they've said, I don't know what you've got, but I see something that I need and I want it. It is an opening and a door that is very, very, very much needed in today's world. We've just got to be more free to share. Someone described our challenge here as one beggar telling another beggar where to find food. We found it. I'm not talking about what's in Bailey Hall right now. We'll try that later. But I'm really talking about we found the real food that nourishes the soul. And we've got to share that. We're not only on Heritage Sunday will we be packed, but there'll be people coming and yearning because they'll find something that they have that is missing in their lives that only God can provide. Don't you find it amazing that in the scriptures you find Jesus telling his disciples, he talked to them about discipleship. And he said, if you follow me, there are going to be some challenges. You're going to find that even maybe your family may not like you. And they may reject you. There'll be persecution. There'll be all sorts of things that may happen to you. That's what will happen if you follow me. But you know what happened instead of just people running away from Jesus? They were running toward Jesus because they had seen something in him that they needed in their life. And they knew it was of great value. And so they left their fishing business. They left their accountant's office. They left all of these things behind in order to follow Jesus, because nothing was more valuable than experiencing what they knew Jesus could provide them. It's like a treasure found in a field. It's like a pearl of great price. It's of greater value than anything else that you've ever experienced. It's the more of life. It's what the best you could think. And then it's even more than that. Last week we celebrated 15 years, the 15th anniversary of 9/11. And there's probably not a person who is old enough, at least to remember that time, who does not know exactly where you were, what you were doing, and what was going on in your life at that time. I mean, it was like a marker. We could tell stories about exactly where you were and how that all you knowledge of that came to your to you. There were phone calls that we heard later of husbands and wives who called their spouse and left a message just to tell their loved ones that they loved them and things were not looking good. Well, in all the loss of our sense of safety and the abundance of fear that has developed as a part of that tragic experience and horrible experience, of the knowledge that evil, yes, can get to us here in the United States, that we're not exempt from it, all of those things that we lost in that. You know, there was a glimmer of hope, I think, that came in the midst of that. Do you remember the Sunday after 9/11? I don't know if it was true here, but in other pastors I've talked to, and it was true in the church that I served, I thought it was Easter. There were people in church I just had not seen. I didn't not even seen them in the community, but they were there. It was packed. Because you see, there is within all of us, our brothers and sisters within the fellowship, but our brothers and sisters who have not yet claimed the name. There is something that when you take the props out and when life becomes so questionable, there is something in us that draws us back to God and the church. We saw that in churches across the land. Now, I wish I could tell you that the second and third Sunday after they were there, but they, anyway, I won't go there. But they did respond that first Sunday. Let me share a story. It's of one told by my favorite preacher, who has gone on to be with the Lord now, Dr. Fred Craddock, also one of my seminary professors. Dr. Craddock tells a story of having dinner with one of his parishioners, and they had small children, and after dinner they went into the den and sat down and talked, and the kids were playing with this rather large, narrow dog. The husband saw that they were what Craddock was looking at the dog, and said, and by the way, the tear may come here about the dogs if you watched the game yesterday, but anyway, we'll move on. But the husband said, "That's a full-blooded greyhound. We got him when his racing days were over." And after a while, the kids played some more, and it was time for bed. So the husband and wife took the children upstairs to the bedroom, leaving Craddock and the dog there by himself. This is where the story gets interesting. Craddock asked the dog, "What's it like being a greyhound and racing professionally?" And the dog responded, "Well, it's really quite nice." He said, "I really had it made down there in Florida." He said, "All the food you could eat, they cared for me well. Really, it was great." Craddock asked, "Well, why did you stop?" And the dog responded, "Well, you would have to know something about greyhound racing to know that." He said, "You see, if you had ever gone to a greyhound race, they take all of the dogs and we are lined up. And there is this white rabbit thing that they pull around along the track and they release us and we chase after it. And we do that every time." He said, one day I got over close to where that rabbit was. I wanted to see it and check it out, only to find, to my dismay, that rabbit was not real. And therefore," he said, "I quit. I quit." One of the great fears I think maybe all of us have at some point in time in our journey called life is that which we have valued or that which we have chased after in life is really not worth our investment. That would be a horrible commentary, would it not be, to spend your life chasing something that is not real. Jesus reminds us this morning, and hear me with clarity, He reminds us that Jesus is real. That Jesus is more than you ever expected, more than you ever dreamed of. He is all of that. He is the one who we can turn our lives to. He is the one who loves us more than we can even imagine. And there is absolutely nothing that can compare with the blessings of claiming God's amazing grace and tremendous love. There's nothing out there. The world cannot offer it. And yet we are the ones who have the great joy of not only discovering it, but responding by giving our all, saying, "Here I am, Lord. I know you love me because I know you died on the cross for my sins. I know that you offer life in such abundance that there is great joy when I give myself completely to you and serve you without reservation." Jesus always offers more than we expect. He provides that. You'll never regret your investment in Jesus. He is real. He is the one who gives meaning to our lives and purpose to our living. He's the one we serve. That's why this church stands here in this place. It's because we believe that. And we are willing to serve Him, to spread the good news to this community, and to seek to draw as many persons into that loving relationship as possible. We have a heritage. It is that heritage that we extend beyond ourselves for someone else who does not yet know the Christ and the joy He brings to our hearts and how real He is and how transforming He is of our lives. He's the one we serve today. And to that we say, thanks be to God. This morning as we respond, the choir will lead us in a time of response to the Word. Will you use this time as you listen to the choir, listen to their anthem? Use this as a time of preparing yourself. What are you sensing God saying to you from His Word today? If you feel like, I need to come to this altar, I need to say, God, I've taken you for granted. You may need to come to this altar just to say, Lord, thank you for being who you are. I love you. Would you allow God to work in you as you would have Him work in you, as He draws us all closer and closer to Himself?
Spirit.
stand as you're able for our hymn of invitation. Hymn number 98. We'll sing all three verses of To God Be the Glory. Please stand.
Benediction and a blessing for the meal. Just a couple reminders. First of all, those of you members who are 50 years or more in the church, we want to take a picture immediately following, as well as the pastors. If you make your way to the front, we'll have those pictures made. And also the meal, remember it's an open invitation to all our visitors. We hope you'll come and share that time of table fellowship with us as we gather in Bailey Hall immediately following the benediction. Also, one last recognition. Hang in there. You're doing great. Michael Dean, come see me. The first service was held in this sanctuary September 11, 1966. The first baby baptized in this church was baptized in that service September 11, 1966. Michael Dean was that baby. Michael, bless you, brother. We celebrate that with you and all who've been baptized in this wonderful place of worship in the years of the fall. Michael, bless you.
Would you receive this benediction and blessing? You can leave this building, but you cannot leave the church. For where you are, there is the church also. Go forth now in the blessings of God, the rich wonder of His love and His grace. May the Lord pour out His blessings upon the good gift of food, the hands that have prepared it, and upon us who receive it, as we celebrate together the history of the last 50 years that God has blessed us in this place. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.